I am a tree, bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of the sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh,
Okay. Hello, everybody. Let me make sure my tie is good. Hello. Welcome to Spirit Nation. Those who are online, let's see who we got so we can get started on tonight. Let's see what we got here. Amen. All righty. Amen. Don't forget to share the broadcast. Thank you, honey, for throwing that up there. Amen. Let's see. I hope everyone is doing well. This is Thursday. This is our almost to the end of our, I guess you could say, end time teaching. We've been at it since, I think, October or later, late September, something like that. But anyway, we are here and we are ready to get rolling. All right. We've had a powerful time in God last Sunday. Those who are part of that, either online or in person, the testimonies are coming in at a rapid pace. And I thank God for what is established for you and I. And like the song just said, oh, how he loves us. And that's just have to know that for yourself. Amen. Just have to know that he loves you no matter, and in spite of you, he loves you. Amen. All right. Good evening to you, Nardo and Kathy. Almost time for the big surprise. Amen. Amen. So happy for you all. And me and Prophetess will be there. Amen. Amen. All right. Hello, Aubrey. What's up, my man? Good to see you on tonight. And Amber, hello. I heard the good news about what came your way. And Prophetess will be getting with you about that situation because we want the world to know that God loves people. Amen. And let's see. Of course, Kathy. Hello, Mom. let's see here. Of course, the elders are on. Faith and Aaron. God bless you both. Of course, my great sisters are on here. I see you, Tiff. I know Nikki's in here. I know Tammy's in the house as well. God bless you all. My cool brothers on there. Mr. Tim Johnson. Amen. God bless you, my bro. And then we got Mike and April. Hello to you both. Amen. The power couple and Teresa and Davin. More power couples. And of course, Tanika, I'll send you the first. Hello to you. Amen. Answers are coming your way, man. All right. And then we got Roxy. And of course, hey, Christy, good evening to you. And of course, we have Lexi and Cam and all those who are walking around your kitchen, your homes, or in your car driving, who are unable to send a shout out to us. We send a shout out to you. Amen. We're glad you're here. We're glad you're logging on. And don't forget to share this to your family. Today's message is very, very, very important. Amen. Very. And I think when we go over this, you are going to see a whole lot of things that you get more increase. There we go. And remember, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 1 that those who read and understand this book of prophecy, a blessing shall come upon them. So those who've been sticking with us throughout the weeks and months, a blessing will come upon you at the conclusion of this series. I decree that, and that's going to happen. Amen. It'll be one of those blessings that God shocks you. As a matter of fact, it'll be three blessings coming upon you for sticking with it. Amen. That's what God has told me in my right ear. Three will come for you for sticking through us dealing with the book of Revelation, because it's a promise from him to you. Amen. To us. Amen. So we are excited about what God has already ordained for us to walk in. Amen. Ordained for us to walk in. And we are excited about the future. We're excited about your future. Listen, if you're in the local area and you have not come out to Spirit Nation to experience God in person, you are missing mantles being dropped every Sunday. Listen, come on out. You'll be surprised, or you're welcome where we're at. We don't judge people based on skin color, ideas, position, etc. We love everybody that comes in, and we have order. Amen. We'd love to have you, and God will speak to you directly. God will help you. Amen. And that is a fact when you come into Spirit Nation. And I have some concepts inside of my head that God is speaking to me about. And we are going to take Spirit Nation outside the borders of Virginia here very, very soon. Amen. And so we're working on that now. And we're just trying to figure out some dates, some itineraries. Actually, my good friend who's a pastor in St. Louis, we plan to be out that way sometime this year. The great state of Texas, we plan to be there sometime this year. Of course, we're going overseas to Zimbabwe to see our own covering. And also, we are also going into Ethiopia to do some ministry work there as well. And God is just opening doors for us. Amen. So we are ministers expanding very rapidly, very fast. And God is giving us the resources, the talent, and the right support system to make sure that his work is done first class, because that's the only way that we know how to do it. Amen. We got first class all the way down to the chicken sandwiches. Amen. Chicken salad sandwiches. So thank you to Mike and April for putting that first class display on last week. We'll have more of those in the future. And we are looking forward to just bringing people together as we move into the next dimension. And we have some more wonderful things going on. We'll get to that, you know, in our announcements. If you're there on Sundays or you watch the replay, listen to the announcements. We have something we're kind of cooking up something special for Easter Sunday, just kind of working out some kinks, etc. And we'll make that announcement how we are going to do Easter. It's not a church, again, that does things with standard, same old. We do things different. Amen. We do things to get the community involved, to show them that God loves them too. Even though they may ignore him, he doesn't ignore them. And we make that known to them, so guilt and condemnation is not ruining their advance and ruining their flight to go into a next level or to just know who God is. We welcome everybody. And like I told some other guys who are coming, who are new or of a different faith, just keep coming, man. The more you get around the people of God, you'll begin to catch fire. And I put in my personal post this week that, you know, burn for Jesus and watch the world come see you burn. And that's a good thing. I mean, you're not burning at the stake, but you're burning for God. And we want people to come and burn for Jesus. And then you, man of God, and your family, once the man catches fire, then the wife catches fire. And you know how fire gets together, it gets bigger. And then the kids catch fire, and then it gets bigger. And that just trickles down into your bloodline that doesn't even live with you. So you're coming to church, you're being a part of God, etc., and the things we're doing is not in vain. Watch how your family changes, because when we're racing towards the end, and when it's all said and done, you'll be glad that you came and caught fire. Amen. Amen. So we're moving in that direction. Yes, but we're working on it. Amen. And we are, again, it's an open invitation. Invite your friends, invite your families. We have Power Up Sunday coming this Sunday. And we also are going to have our healing line and our prophecy, etc. That's going to happen every Sunday. So bring your family. They need help. Bring them. Amen. God will talk to them. God will help them. And we got plenty of testimonies to share with the populace at large to show that, listen, we're not here to make things up or a church that has concocted or paid anybody to act on our behalf. No, this is signs, wonders, miracles, mighty deeds in action. And there's so many things that happen. And this is the year for this ministry and those attached to it of signs, wonders, mighty deeds. Amen. And miracles. So we are moving at light speed. We want you to be a part of it. All right, class, we have spent the last several weeks, starting in 2023, dealing with the end times. And we have worked our way from the day after the rapture. We went into the church ages. We went into 7 years in heaven. We went into the millennial reign. I mean, we went into some deep areas of the Bible so we can learn about what does God say about the end, to build your faith up. And we're kind of rolling it around now, dealing with the church ages, and today's message dealing with the last church, dealing with Laodicea. And I'm also going to take a deep dive with you into what the Nicolaitans are and what that means, because God mentions that in two or three churches that he hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans. And we're going to break that down, and you really want to get in on that. Because that is, not only is it brilliant, but you're going to understand why certain things happen in the church, why certain things happen. Maybe you were a partaker of the Nicolaitan scheme or the spirit of the Nicolaitans, because it's a very deep subject. It's not taught But today you're going to get revelation that you have not heard before. So share this broadcast. Bring them in. I think and I know they're going to be much, much blessed when they learn about this, especially if you are a church leader on tonight. You want to get in on this, get your eldership in there, your deacons, your ministers. You want them to get in on this, because when I get into that, it's going to help you get revelation and also help you structure the future of your church, your branches, etc. So there's not no fallout that the devil has scheduled for you. Because when you deal with the Nicolaitans, you're dealing with a spirit that specializes in incognito operations, clandestine operations, where you don't even know he's there or they are there. But today you're going to find out, and we're going to expose what that is today. But first, let's deal with the lax church, the Laodiceans. Amen. Well, God, we are here. Help us, God, tonight as we work on this word, Lord. I step out the way so you can teach your people on tonight, and may they have a wonderful, wonderful time in you and learn something new about themselves and also about what you said about the churches of Asia. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. All right, class. Listen, just a few more things before I get started. Listen. Men, the Spirit Nation men, we are supposed to be meeting Saturday. So I need somebody to post that back into our little group chat so we know what to do, where to do, and how to do it. So Saturdays are coming, and we're just a couple days away from Saturday, but I want all the men to have an opportunity to get in on the fellowship on the Saturday, etc. Amen. And a special thank you to my beautiful honey, the prophetess, who has done a miraculous job putting things together for the ministry and these videos you see. She does all that single-handedly. Amen. And we're so glad, and we thank God for it. Thank you, honey. Look, she bought me some water. God bless you. We're so glad for her. She's doing a wonderful job in keeping this thing going and moving in that direction, maximizing our reach into the community and the subsectors of our nation. Amen. Okay, let's get started. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 14, Laodicea. Here we go. I'll give you some time to find that in your Bible or your phone. While you do that, I'm going to sip on this water straight from Lake Minnetonka. Amen. From the heavenlies. Oh, that was good, honey. You must have put your finger in it. Amen. Amen. All right. Amen. Yes, 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 yes. All right, let's go. And unto the angel, Revelation chapter 3, verse 14, and to the angel of the church of Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen, my God, the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. 15, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew ye out of my mouth. 17, because you say, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich with right raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thy eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in with him, and he will sup with me, and he me with him. 21. To him that overcome will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. 22. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. My God. Chapter 4, verse 1. After this, I looked up, and behold, a door was open in heaven, and the first voice which I heard, as if it was a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up here. There is your rapture. We'll get to that next week. I figured I'd throw that in free of charge tonight. Amen. There's your rapture right there. Next week, we're going to deal with the rapture, perhaps. Amen. Depends on how we go tonight, because I think the Nicolaitans may take some time. Amen. All right, here we go. So here it is. We have raced through time, and Jesus has given us a picture of the church up all the way up into the Laodiceans, and I'm about to break that down as well. And so we understand that these churches represent the church culture today, or the spirit, and every church that you see on the corner or in the world falls into one of these seven categories. You have a church that's lost their first love. You have a church that's persecuted like Smyrna. You have a church that compromises, that let the man of God or woman of God or whomever get away with all kinds of sexual immorality. And then you have the church called Thyatira, where the person is leading as the number two in power, but controlling everything and everybody, and everybody's miserable. And then you have the dead church we talked about last week, meaning Sardis, the one that looked like they were alive, but God said you're dead. And then we have the church that's full of brotherly love, that works with the community, that helps the community, that loves and understands the power of God's word through the power of love, and the gifts flow freely. And now we may race all the way to after those six churches, and now we're coming to Laodicea. And when I read this, and you read this, and I read this, we can see that this particular body is lukewarm, as God has indicated, meaning that it's going through the motions, because in their mind they say, I have need of nothing, because I live in the United States of America. And I'm not saying that America is the church of Laodicea, but I guarantee you, and you can agree with this, amen, that a lot of the Laodicean churches are in America, because there is no combat, there's no nothing. We'll get there. Let me slow down a little bit. But we understand that lukewarmness has taken over the church at large. And now we have to move into a space now where we have an understanding that even God himself said, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. Why would he say something like that? My loving God would say, because you're neither cold nor hot, but because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out. Why? Because lukewarm churches attract a dead and dying and crying society, because what they offer is not the power of God, but the power of entertainment. And what they draw people in by is first and foremost, is entertainment. We come in, and this church, Let me sip on this drink here, because I feel like I need to take my time on this. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's good. That must be from Lake Heaven or Lake Minnetonka. Amen. And so God comes on the scene before I break down all the variables. He comes on the scene in chapter 3, verse 14, and he says something so powerful. He always helped me and you out when he's talking about the seven churches. Listen, and unto the angel or the pastor of the church of the Laodiceans, write these things, says the amen. Let me just underline this word here. Amen. My pen is shot. My pen is shot, honey. I'm good. I'm good, honey. Thank you. He says, these things says the amen. I had to stop there because Jesus put that there for you and I to recognize him and us in him. These things says the amen. In other words, he is not the author, nor the perpetuator, nor the endorser, nor the backing of the cliche, delayed but not denied mentality that sweeps across the church culture. He says, I am the amen. In other words, after you pray for a thing and you say in Jesus' name, amen, he says, I'm that guy. It's done. Now, if it's not happening for you, you are praying amiss. The Bible says you have prayed amiss. My God. And so we understand now that since he is the amen, anything I pray for now, I should have full confidence that it's done when I say amen. Now, most people, and how some of us have been trained back in the day, is we have to keep praying for a thing and praying for a thing. But you know what that really means? That really means that I'm praying because I really don't believe the prayer I said yesterday about the same thing. So I got to keep praying about it because I haven't seen no manifestation. But if I got a revelation that God moves in the realm of faith, then we understand when I say amen, I receive it. Because he says, when you stand praying, believe that you have received and you shall have. You'll find that in Mark chapter 11. He said, you shall, past, future tense, you shall have everything that you prayed about. Now, where people and where believers miss it at is when we say amen, we go on the shock factor, or we don't believe what we prayed, so we got to keep doing it as if you're making, as if God has put a rule in the Bible that says, repeat the prayer 27 times and I'll do it. And that's contrary to what he told us in John 16 and John 14 when he says, in that day, you will ask me nothing. When God was referring to somebody being healed, he says, why do you stand near here gazing and bothering me? And if we look and read the Gospels and look at how Jesus dealt with devils and healings, deformities, he commanded the issue to be changed. He didn't pray about it. He commanded. We'll get there Sunday, so make sure you come in on Sunday, amen. But here he is. He says, I am the amen. My God, let me sip on that for the homies who ain't here. My God, I am, it should encourage your heart. I am the amen. So God wants it just as bad as you do to happen for you, but you have to know him as the amen. Shabbatina bala. Come on, work with me now. So if you know him as the amen, the next day, I'm not praying the same thing. What I'm doing now is I'm working the word and using my faith to move the mountain out the way, because as soon as I said amen, it was done. You hear me? So I don't say I'm praying for your sister. I'm praying for your brother. Why? We prayed about it. It's done. Why are you still worried about it? So when things come across my inbox that come through my wife, I say, why are we still talking about this? We've already dealt with this. Why does this person keep bringing this up? Because now it lets me know, as a man of God, these people have no faith. So now I have to go teach on faith because I marvel that they don't believe God. Amen. So here it is, Jesus motivating us, saying, amen, that I am the amen. It's so powerful to me. And so now when I lay hands on any situation and command it to work and say, amen, Jesus stamps it. It's done, sir. It's done. Amen. When I lay hands on my beautiful wife in a spiritual way, let me say it that way, amen, and commanded a baby to get in there, when we said amen together, we didn't go and try to do something different and pray about it. I didn't pray about it not none time after that. That's even after 16 negative pregnancy tests that came across my eyeballs. And even in that, when my heart dropped, I said, nope, we prayed about this. I know it's coming to pass. And Janae Laudermilk is here. And she's upstairs running around. I can hear her. Amen. You understand what I'm saying? So doing the 16 negative tests, and that's about 16 months, by the way, if you must know. So that's a faith fight. Because my head is fighting my spirit that's in my heart. It's saying, it's not coming to pass. You're too old. Y'all 42 years old. Why you want a baby? Yada, 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 yada. The devil will fight you in your thought life. But Paul gives us instruction. Cast down vain imaginations. Amen. That come against you. God wants you to have the contract. God wants you to have this, that, and the other. Man, let me not get into Sunday. When he says amen, we'll get there Sunday. I had to stop myself. when we get into what the amen is, it's finished. And to the angel of the church of Laodicea write, these things says the amen. You understand? The faithful and true witness. He has to put all those other adjectives, the faithful and the true witness, so we can understand that he doesn't change. When he says, I am the amen, He stands right there at the end of our prayer, and then he adds to it, I'm the faithful witness and the true stuff. Amen. I'm not Bishop Buttertoes, who's wishy-washy because he's hungry. I'm not Sister Hoof and Foot because she wishy-washy because she got an attitude problem and she goes through menopause. You understand? I'll leave it there. You're making me laugh, honey. Amen. These things says the faithful and true witness. So now we understand, and now we can debunk this delayed and but not denied, or God doesn't want you to have it yet. How foolish is that? Why would God tell me that he will answer me when I call? Before you call, I'll answer you. Why would he tell me that and then say, you know what? I'm going to delay it for you because you're not ready. How many people with the sound of a click of a button say me have heard that you're not ready yet? And my question to somebody who says that, to what policy or standard are you measuring me that I'm not ready? Because it's God who makes us ready, not a man. He used a man to get his work done, but he'll have his own agenda when it's time for it. You get what I'm saying? Amen. And Miss Virginia, my wife, will call you tomorrow. Did you call today? You did. Amen. God bless you. I didn't know that. Okay. But here it is, the faithful and true witness. We got that. You're not qualified. And so what that gets in your spirit is now you become lukewarm because you think God is not answering your petitions, or he doesn't care about you. Shabotila monaka. See what I'm saying, class? I'm giving you why you have lost fire for God. Because people have lied to you saying you're not ready, you're not going to get your million, you're not going to get healed, you're not going to be a minister of the gospel. Listen, if they say you're not going to be a preacher, they're lying. Because what did Jesus say? Go into all the world and preach the gospel. You may not be a pastor, but everybody had the commission to preach. So go preach. Amen. You may not be a prophet. You may not be an apostle. And that's okay. Remember, there's a double judgment line for those in an office. Remember, you ain't gotta, if not called to that, don't try to jog forward. And I'm going to give that in a second. So now, yeah, Mike, you don't hear it from me. So now what we have is people getting lukewarm because they've been told they're not ready, or their lifestyle isn't conducive to be full of the Spirit. What's that mean? Paul says being full of the Spirit. In other words, your relationship with God, your fire for God, your spending time in his word. You are getting full of the Spirit when you pray in the Spirit. But guess what? I'll break it down on Sunday. Amen. About living in the Spirit, praying in the Spirit, and also praying in tongues. Three different things. We'll get to a Sunday. But you get my drift. But people who don't have their prayers answered now become lukewarm because nothing's happening. You have prayed, and but man, God, I'm going to keep on praying. But you did not pray in faith the first time you asked, because you keep praying about it. So it now negates what you did have because you didn't believe it anyway. So you can't come to the prophet and expect me to reverse it when you yourself don't believe. And Paul tells Timothy to war with the prophecies that were spoken over you. So with your prophetic word, you can't sit there like a bump on the log as if you're going to drink Kool-Aid and wait for the cow to come. If I prophesy the cow is coming, go and find the cow, then slaughter him, because the path is already made. That's how you war with prophecy. You got to take this thing like a battle axe and beat that thing to the whole thing cracked, because you're guaranteed victory if a real prophet, and you're looking at one, prophesies to you. Ah, somebody kind of lie. So you understand this, class. Do it. And then the act of faith, when you get a prophetic word, show God, is do something to show God I'm in faith. I say it again. Sometimes it involves doing something, saying something, and giving something. It's an act of faith. When our man of God prophesies to us, an act of faith for my wife and I is to put a seed in the ground in his hand. My God, are we getting this tonight? Shobati kabola le ka. So now, what we're doing is now understanding how we got lukewarm. It's because One of the variables is we think that God doesn't listen to us. So now we can say, you know what, this church thing, I'm going to go to church. I'll go to the men's fellowship, you know, but I don't believe God can help me and my wife in a situation, but I'll go with show face because it's the mechanical thing to do. You have just entered into the Sardis anointing. You understand? Deb, but look like you're alive because you don't believe God. And we're going to have a faith infusion in a few months from now. Amen. So now, class. Amen. Now. Oh, so I'll be getting this. Amen. Okay. This thing says the amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. In other words, he's telling me I am the beginning, the alpha, and the omega, the end. So he is our foundation. He is our covering. And so why should I fear man or any devil? Because God has got, how we say it, class, in this generation, God got me. Literally, he does. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. So he is our foundation. He is our covering. And so we have this assurance in him that he will not fail us even at the last minute, I believe. My God, we break this thing down. I believe. You believe. Let's all believe. In the last minute, I believe what he has promised to me, that he is able also to perform it. That's a fact. The creation of God. 15. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were either. So because you're lukewarm, you lost your fire for God. Because life has been hard because you confess hardness your entire life. Because the people have taught you to confess the problem instead of commanding the solution. My God, say it again for the class in the back. You have confessed the problem instead of commanding the solution. Because when you understand that you're a little G-O-D, he said, the Son of Man is like a man who went to a far journey, and then when he left his house, he had a power to his servants and told them to occupy until I come. Let me break that down for you. What that means is, I'm gonna use my natural job. When my boss leaves and she needs to turn power over to somebody so she can enjoy her vacation, she turns power over to me to execute in her absence and on her behalf. It's the same principle here. Here it is, Jesus left power for you and I to occupy everything until he comes back. But what has creeped into the church, especially the Laodicean churches, is this lukewarmness where now we can become victims of our own ego and victims acting like I'm so humble. I gotta be humble. You keep saying that because you don't believe God. You don't believe God called you a little G-O-D. And so when you read Psalms 82 and it says, I will judge amongst the gods, don't you know that I have called you little G-O-Ds? This is what God said, not me. It's in your Bible. Read it. Occupy till I come. For the Son of Man did not come to seek. My God, honey. Okay, I'm trying to get off this. He says, I come to seek and to save that which was lost. Not who which was lost. That which was lost when Adam bit the apple and man fell was entertainment, was business, was government. Of course it was souls. Absolutely. It was the Hollywood. It's the Oscars. It's the music industry. It's everything that we know was lost to the devil's stream because of one man's disobedience. But because of one man's obedience, all power was in his hands, and he gave it to you and I to
occupied until he comes. And so in your heart, you knew you were supposed to be a doctor. But Bishop Big Toes said, go to the army and be a private first class for 30 years so you can get a retirement. But all in all, you always knew in your heart that you wanted to be a doctor, but you didn't do it. And God put the very dream that's in your heart that's been folded in a napkin. Shaki Kobaleka. So now we have a bunch of people frustrated as if God doesn't want them to prosper and be in good health or to succeed in him and through him. And so now we have mechanical people going to mega churches. Let me get into it now. Let me get into it now. Amen. You were called to be in politics. Did you not know that you're supposed to be the vice president of the United States? Because you have a knack for debate. You have a knack for leadership. But because of fear that was taught to you by devils around you, you have settled for the bakery at Walmart. Knowing that your mouth that you have was meant for the kingdom of God and your understanding of politics was meant for the kingdom of God to be a representative in political spaces. But the lukewarm church will drag you out of your God-given calling. I'm telling you, class, this is what happens when the devil comes and takes the fire out of you. Because if the fire is on you, you understand that, wait a minute, I should occupy till he comes. And so that means that any warfare comes against you, you're not having a pity party in the bathroom prostrate as if that's pleasing God. Get up and fight. Get up and do something. Your kids are going to hell, but you're sitting out drinking brew and drinking sweet tea and saying, well, kids are going to be kids. Are you crazy? These kids need our prayers. They need our intercession. Go get them and snatch them out the fire and say, what's wrong with you? You know, who raised you like this? What you talking about? You like girls now, you a whole girl. What's wrong with you? You a boy, now you like boys. Who cast the devil out of them for the first thing? And then put the power of God in them through the laying on of hands and your priest's word. Let me calm down. I'm trying to understand and show what the Laodicean church does. The Laodicean church in context was not hot for God. And they wasn't cold either. In other words, they went all the way dead. But what they were was they allowed anything, and the power of God was not there. And so in the mega church where everybody's there, the head man is standing there smiling, saying, ain't God good? Did you guys like the band? Did you get your coffee this morning? God is nowhere because there's no healing. There's no prophecy. There's no laying on of hands. There's no sons. There's nothing going on in that ministry. But because it has a lot of members and it's a mega church with a circus outside and a kids pool out in the back and the pastor got a personal foot massager and a barber and all that, we think they made it. But there's nothing happening through power for the people. But we went to church on Sunday and boy, was that message motivating. Woo! Wasn't it good? I feel good today. But let me tell you something about lukewarm people. They thrive on motivation. But here's the secret about motivation. Motivation comes and goes. I could be motivated to go run 5 miles tomorrow. By the time from 8:44 p.m. on the East Coast and 6 a.m. when I said I'm going to do it, my motivation may change. I need some OZs. I've had a long week. I'm not really motivated. I was motivated at 8:44 p.m., honey. But 6 a.m., it's warm. This bed is warm. It's cold outside, and I ain't getting up. Motivation come and go. But what happens is these motivational speakers who have big platforms and microphones now are teaching motivational messages with no power, no dream interpretation, no healing, no prophecy. And so people are left amiss or dormant and don't know what God is saying because they're following a motivational speaker who gets them motivated to stay in a dead marriage, keeps them motivated to raise and do demonic things, keeps them motivated to be in trash, but nobody ever comes out. There's no prophet in the house. There's no apostle in the house. There's nobody to say, wait a minute, something is off here. Where is the prophet? Why? Because Moses, who is and was the prophet of God and the man of God, all in one, took the children of Israel out of Egypt, and by a prophet did Israel come out of Egypt, and by a prophet was she preserved. So there is some preserving and coming out power that's attached to the prophet. And so once you get around one, your life should get better. You should come out of sexual immorality. You should come out of drug use. You should go into the newness of life, because a prophet has taken his calling serious and has taken you out. But in mega churches, you don't have a prophet nowhere. Maybe, am I too loud? There's no prophet nowhere. And the prophet's job is to bring people up and out. My God, one of my elders, one of my pastors, throw that scripture into the chat so everybody can see it, that the prophet brings you up and out of Egypt, not keep you buried and in Egypt. Let me get in this water. I wasn't supposed to do all this tonight. By a prophet was she preserved. So the Laodicean church shuts the mouths of prophets, because one, they scared of them, because prophet will expose that this place is dead as Julius Caesar bones. And what's happening here is you got to do this, and they come with the finger of God to add direction and point. They don't want your church. No, not real prophets. We work for God and God alone. That's it. But a prophet can come and bless your ministry. I'm telling you what, I'm talking to one that is packing in the spirit. I ain't talking to somebody who's new, who's still in the school of the prophets. I'm talking about one that God has positioned and you can see the oil on his life. Those are the ones God commissions to come and help you. I can't get deep on that, but I have to keep moving another way. Up and out. One of y'all elders post that scripture in the group chat. Chop, chop. Thank you so much. Amen. And one of y'all, one of the pastors, Pastor Kim, somebody, that Israel was preserved by a prophet. And by a prophet was she preserved. Type it in Google, it'll come up. My God. I want people to see it. I'm not making this stuff up. It's in the Bible. Amen. Anyway, by a prophet has starts. The Lord brought Israel out of Egypt, and by a prophet was she preserved. Amen. I need one of these elders of Spirit Nation and one of these pastors of Spirit Nation. I need you to post that in the chat like an hour ago. Thank you so much. Amen. Anyway, let's keep going while we wait on the scripture so I can move on. Okay. And it says here, I know thy works, that you're neither cold nor hot. I would that you were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. I'm going to spit you out. Shobate kalalo ko. Put the verse in chapter 2, please. Sheko batateolo ka. Thank you, Tanika. Shedako, but y'all need to get on it, man. I'm telling y'all, move faster. That's a prophet rebuking his own team in love, of course. He said, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. Mm-hmm. Ain't that something, honey? Yeah. Yeah. I think it's so dangerous to get spit out of the Lord's mouth when he stops using you. But God, and we heard the whole saying, that God will fire you and let you still keep working. We understand that. Mm-hmm. Amen. We understand that. That God will fire you, but let you keep working. I don't need no co-signers. Thank you. So now we have this whole thing going. Listen, we're neither cold nor hot. Aaron, we have it, Aaron. We good. Tell them to stop. Cold nor hot, So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spit you out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, miserable, poor, and blind, and naked. 18, I counsel thee, buy me gold tried in fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. My God in heaven, as many as I love and chasten, I rebuke. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Verse 20 is so critical. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Here it is, class. I said it last week. Here it is. The Lord is outside the church knocking, trying to get in, while they're having a almost borderline demonic Easter service, while they're spitting on people, while they're doing all kind of craziness. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anybody hears my voice and lets me in, I will come in and dine with them and them with me. So it could be the Laodicean church has money. Because you are rich, he says, I have need of nothing. Everybody has a Lamborghini. Everybody has a nice car. Everybody has this and money. Money's not a problem. But what is the problem is that God is not in it. My God, honey, because there is no power flowing through the church, no one being healed. We have a deaf and dumb section of people who are coming in begging for God to help them, and they don't know how to be or get delivered from the devil. Say it. Wow. The power is not flowing. Amen. I watched for years somebody in a certain church who was stricken by a certain device. And I said, man, they keep going to the altar, but nothing's happening. And at that time, I didn't know any better. Going to the altar, but nothing happened. Wow. Anyway, Jesus is standing outside the door, knocking, but nobody's answering. Wow. So think about that. That we can have church, we can have an emotional experience and have the best sound equipment and then have the best everything. But the Lord is not in the church. People are on the floor crying, covered in sheets, whining like some wimps, as if God didn't give them the power to deal with the devil or deal with the spirit that they have concocted that's harassing their family, and now they're in a corner crying because they think that moves the hand of God. We've all been there, including me. If I go and run around 10 times, that God is going to hear me out. That's so far from the truth. When I became a son, I said, why wouldn't my dad want me to have the best? Why wouldn't my dad want me healed? I've never had COVID. Neither has my wife or my children. I said out of my mouth when that thing took off and everybody was quarantined, I said, you will not touch this family. And it hasn't. And my wife is my witness. Nobody's had to go into quarantine. Nobody's ever had COVID because I wasn't receiving it and I wasn't watching the news to have faith to get it. People are watching Fox News all day, looking at the New York governor talk about all the deaths he had. And so people had more faith in getting it, my God in heaven, than not getting it. And so I kept my mind on the things of God. I've been watching that, like, for what? I'm going to Royal Farms to get me some gas, to get me a drink, etc. I had faith to be healed, and I am, and was. And so I don't need to wear a mask all day. Some people wear that mask still because they got faith in the mask. I'm not throwing shade at you mask wearers. In the church, where the Holy Ghost is moving, they got the mask on. Where the fire God is flowing, the mask is on tight. Shakobatikalaka. Believe God, and you shall be healed. I said that. Amen. Yes, I did. Have faith. What did God tell the disciples? Master, the tree that you cursed has withered away. And what does the Lord say to his 12 disciples, who he had called apostles, who had not went into official service yet, but he named them apostles after all that prayer session? That's a whole nother sermon. He said to them, have faith in God. That's all he said. Then he says more things, of course. But if you think about the context of God talking to them, who was God himself, said, have faith in me. That if you say unto this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in your spirit, your heart, whatsoever thing that you say, you shall have them. Future tense. My God, have faith in God that you'll get your baby back. Have faith in God that he'll cancel debt that you incurred because you didn't have right thinking. It wasn't because you didn't have enough money, because money's attracted to those who knows how to massage it, how to work it, how to use it. It's attracted to people who relate to it well. I'm telling you, I'm on fire tonight. Amen. Oh, my wife is so brilliant. Amen. Brilliant. So Jesus is outside the door knocking, saying, let me in. Let me in. Let me in. I'm here. Let me in. Outside the church. Outside. He's looking at the coffee bar. He's in the parking lot that's painted with BMWs and everything else. He said, listen, let me in, because there's no healing, no dream interpretation, no prophecy, no nothing. And you can't say that your church is moving in power when you have one prophetic conference that lasts 5 days once a year. That's not how this works. Amen. Let me in. I can't say this enough. And Jesus even talks about that. He says, listen, foxes have holes. The birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't have a place to lay his head. In our individual lives, this is the Laodicean church. In the individual lives and the church, I don't have a place in their life. Those hidden doors in their heart, I've been knocking, but they're not opening the door to me. I saw the rape, but I'm knocking at the trauma door to get you delivered. But Deacon Big Belly has told you that you got to go through 9 years of counseling and you got to sit down here, but you're getting older by the day and now your knees hurt. And now you want to go dance like David danced, but your knees are not. Shakobalaka, death to that lie in Jesus' name. Sobatati shaka. What you do to me tonight? Knocking on the doors. The Laodicean church doesn't open the door because they're lukewarm. They know there's trauma that happened when they were 5 years old, 10 years old, 15, 21, 25, what have you. But because they're lukewarm, now their heart is guarded. And they won't let the Lord in anywhere, even when they're in the face of God's prophet, who God speaks through to them, they still won't believe. Anyway, still won't believe. I counsel thee to buy of me. Let me hurry up. I'm trying to get to the Nicolaitans. Gold tried in fire, that thou mayest be rich, that thou may be rich. There it is, class. Those who think God doesn't want you rich, look what he says. I counsel thee. In other words, I persuade thee. I'm trying to help you. Listen. I counsel thee, buy of me gold tried in the fire, that you be rich. How is it that we think not having enough makes us spiritual? How be it? Because what we want to do for the cause of Christ requires resources. Ask my wife and I, we know this. And most people tip God. But let me not go there. Amen. Thank you to the heavy hitters who constantly give to the work of God. I'll leave it there. You know who you are. Amen. For thou mayest be rich. and white raiment that thou may be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thy eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and I chasten. In other words, I develop my sons. I develop my daughters. If they're going the wrong way, I'm going to tell them, this is the Lord saying to us, I'm not going to let you fall, not unto him. What you doing? You good? Not unto him who is able to keep us from falling. Anyway, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And that's what the Lord is saying even now. I'm standing at the door knocking. Let me in. Then you will have gold that's been purified by fire. What's that mean? The IRS can't take it away. The devils can't steal your stuff. He gives you. He won't take your house. Someone lied to you and said your vehicle being repossessed was God teaching you something. That's what the Laodiceans teach, that the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. They take it totally out of context. So how does God get glory out of taking my vehicle because I lost my job? Because Deacon Big Belly said, I should pray 70 times, seven times to keep my job. I still lost my job and now I have no job. And now they came and got my car and now I got an eviction notice. And now I'm praying and praying and praying and nothing's happening. Buy from me. Gold tried by fire. Siko batikaleka. Get a stand class. Amen. Amen. So there is the Laodicean church, the last one, up until the rapture, chapter 4, verse 1. So you see the church age where the works of God have been decreased in the church. In Ephesus, they were doing mighty works, in Smyrna and even Pergamos. But Thyatira was the start of the decline where things would begin to stop. But now the Laodicean church has become rich. And they aren't doing anything for God. You understand, class? Mm-hmm. Look at the age we live in. Mm-hmm. Rock bands. Mm-hmm. Not knocking that. We're gonna have a big church too. Mm-hmm. But power will be there. Mm-hmm. That's the difference. Mm-hmm. Power will be there. People coming with complex issues and leaving with solutions. Prophecy will be there. You think I'm gonna be the only prophet of Spirit Nation? Negative. Shakopa, I ain't doing other work. I know what's in the house and what's coming. Power will be there so people can come and be refreshed and get the devil cast out for real. Mm-mm-mm. Anyway, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Chapter 4, verse 1, the rapture. Next week, we're going to talk about the rapture, the grand finale, perhaps. Amen. Let's get into a Nicolaitan spirit. Everybody waiting for this. My wife said, yes. 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 Let's get into this because this is a subject not taught by many. And if they do teach it, they don't teach it correctly. Amen. But tonight we're going to learn something new, shall we? Amen. All right, here we go. Chapter 2. I'm not reading this whole church. I'm going back to where it all began. Amen. Let's see here. Chapter 2, verse 6. But this thou hast. We talk about the Nicolaitans. This thou hast. Thou hast the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Let me get my thing out there for a second. So the Nicolaitans, let me just give some background here. The Nicolaitans came from somebody. Something was starting. Something had infiltrated the church. And you have to remember, the Nicolaitan spirit started in the church. It's not a demonic entity, but it's a spirit that gets on Christians. My God, I mean, I'm not losing my time tonight. Oh, I'm sweating like a mug over here. We will learn tonight. The Nicolaitan spirit is a, let me say it this way. Should I go to Acts? You know what, let me do this. Matthew chapter 10, amen. Let's go there first.
I got to put this foundation here real quick. Matthew chapter 10, verse number 4. I'll give people time to get there because you got to get in on this. We're talking about the Nicolaitans, but I got to put this out here for a second. So, you're welcome, Tanika. I got to put it out here first. Amen. Matthew chapter 10, verse 4, and it says this. It says, Simon the Canaanite. Actually, let me go up to verse number 10, verse 1. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal manner of all sickness and disease. Look at Jesus giving power to his disciples. Are you a disciple? Look what Jesus did. Gave us power. We understand, okay. Verse number 3. Actually, verse number 2. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the publican, James the son of Alphaeus, my God, and Lebesus, whose surname is Thaddeus. 4. Simon the Canaanite and Judas Iscariot, who also would betray him. So here it is, the Lord has happened. When Matthew was writing, he's writing people. These are the apostles that Jesus has named. He goes through everybody's name, but then when he gets to Judas, he said, and Judas Issachar, who will betray him. Okay, we understand that. And Judas. So they're talking about the disciples and Judas, although he's one of the apostles at that time. And Judas. So we have to understand that the Lord put this there for a reason. Now, go over to Acts. Let's see here. Acts chapter 6. Now, the Lord has resurrected. He's gone. He's turned the church over to Peter, who's just a section of Jesus, and the surviving apostles, etc. And now they're setting up church structure. You have to keep in the back of your mind, and Judas. Okay, my wife is getting it. She's giving me the wink, so she gets it. Amen. She gets it. We all get it because she's very brilliant. Amen. So they're making, in this particular chapter, they're setting up church structure. Let me just read the whole thing. Chapter 6, verse 1. And in those days, when the number of disciples were multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. 2. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not the reason, not for reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Here's Peter, who was leading, saying, listen, we don't have time to wait tables. We can't leave the word of God, so we need some help. Verse 3, wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. In other words, find some deacons to be over the things that we can't get to because he can't be everywhere. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word. Now, you know why I defer things to my wife? Because I can't be involved with everything when I'm in prayer, getting ready for whatever God has for me. We understand class, structure. Listen, let me tell you something. If you reach into Spirit Nation for help and you want to talk to me, I'm okay with that. But 9 times out of 10, I'm going to have prophetess reach out to you, okay, initially, because she's a replica of me. So if she's talking, I'm talking. You understand? Does that make sense, honey? Amen. I had to make that public announcement so people don't think that you're packing with the power, ain't you? That was country, ain't you? But we would give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Amen. 5. And the same pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen. Now we know Stephen's record. Stephen was the one that got stoned in the end of his life, and he said, God, don't punish them for what they're doing to me. And the Bible said that God stood up, or Jesus stood up at the right hand of God and looked at Stephen. He said, forgive them. So he had a reputation
a good one, and he was full of the Holy Ghost and power. My God, Shabbatilaka, a New Testament evangelist who was Stephen. A man full of faith and of the, we're going to be long tonight, so you got to go to school tomorrow, what have you. It's okay to drop off, but you don't want to miss Nicolaitan stuff. Amen. A man full of faith and the Holy Ghost, and Philip. We know Philip was powerful because he had three daughters that prophesied. So this man had a prophetic spirit that got on his kids. So he was a man of pure character and right before God. My God in heaven. And Prochorus and Nicanor, if I say that right, let me say my vows, and Timon and Pharmenas and Nicholas, Shikobatanako, and Judas, and Nicholas. Y'all get on. Now work with me now. And Judas, who will betray him, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. We're talking about the Nicolaitan spirit. And Nicholas. Come on, class. Amen. So Nicholas, in this sense, was a guy who jumped from church to church. He was in Judaism, and then he went to Christianity. And now they say, we have these deacons and Nicholas. So they knew, and when the book of Acts was written by Paul, Shikobatalaki, it was written saying, listen, and Nicholas was chosen. At the time, the disciples didn't know they were choosing a demon to be in the church that was in the church on the church staff. My time messed up. So listen, class. So the Nicolaitan spirit is already in the church. It's not coming. It's already there. And in this sense, it was in leadership. Now, Jesus says, listen, thou hast them, or this one thing you have is that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. He didn't say he hated the Nicolaitans. He said, I hate the deeds of what they do. What do they do? Let's find out. Amen. I hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. So now we have a member in the church, on staff, in the pew, or it doesn't matter. They're in the church. And the Nicolaitan spirit is somebody who jumps from church to church trying to find a place of influence. Because they don't like this. They don't have no spiritual father. And if they claim to have one, they're going to betray him. So you wonder, man of God, why that man and woman of God betrayed you. Because the Nicolaitan spirit was in and on them. They were in your leadership chain. They was around the anointing, but in their heart, they knew, they thought they were better than you. Because the Nicolaitan spirit will tell you, you're better than the set man. I'm showing you, class, and those who have churches have to fireproof your ministry. Because this is a demon that does not want to be exposed because it's in the church. Now, this thing gets on the Christian and makes them think that they are more higher than the pastor. This is how it kind of works. They'll bring the pastor a book to read. Relax. They'll bring the pastor something to do that the pastor, why is this come to me for? They'll bring the pastor, did you hear what Bishop Jay said yesterday? No, I didn't. They bring division amongst the people and the leadership because all they want is a position of influence in the church. And so Nicolaitans are what we come from the word Nicole, which translates to the word Nike. You're going to like this. Which translates to the word destroyer of the congregation. I wrote that down too. Nicole, Nike, and Nike is the destroyer of the congregation. So the Nicolaitans are ones who destroy the congregation from the inside. So it's not a spirit of murder. It's not a spirit of this, that, and the other. It's the Nicolaitans on the people who look spiritual. They say, I'm so holy and pure. And this is what they do. They prophesy to members in your church. Has not got the authorization from the set man or his delegated authority, not his wife, if he has one, for you to prophesy, but you feel the need to call a member and talk about that. I see God giving you children. You are Nicolaitan. Because the man of God didn't authorize you to prophesy to the sheep. You a sheep yourself, but you prophesying babies and you ain't got no babies yourself. You prophesying big money and you broke. You prophesying all this. You a Nicolaitan. Shakobatilaka. You a Nicolaitan. Lying to the people. They don't have a spiritual father. Nicolaitans will play the part well, honey. They'll play it well, but they don't have it. And now what happens with Nicolaitans, they start to have sons and daughters within another man's church. The ultimate disrespect. And so when a church split happens, the Nicolaitan dude takes the ones he's won over time and starts the Morningstar Baptist Church, 4th Avenue. New church coming. New God has called us to a new work. No, he didn't. You were Nicolaitan who destroyed the congregation and took that set man's sheep. We wonder why churches split, because Nicolaitans are amongst us. Oh, my God. Now the devil knows this. Remember, the devil is cunning. And so is this spirit. The spirit is cunning inside the church. Now, Nicolai, think about Santa Claus or Saint Nick. Listen, I'm not going to mess with your Christmas because we celebrate it too. Calm down before you hit that dial and listen, hear me out. Saint Nick, Nicolaitan, what does that mean? A destroyer of the congregation, honey. And what's that mean, class? They want to get your focus off the word of God to them. So what does Santa Claus do during the Christmas season? The focus is always supposed to be on Christ. But now the focus has turned to a pot-belly white dude, black dude, Indian dude, Japanese dude, whatever dude. And now he got a red robe on with his nasty butt and some boots on and no drawers on. And now he got kids on his lap. But the reason for the season is the Lord. So now even the church got the big dude up on the pulpit taken away even from the little kids understanding that Christmas is not about getting toys, but about reverencing and honoring the gift that was given to mankind. So Saint Nick, we're in a song and now our kids say, what's Santa Claus? I told my kids, Santa Claus ain't coming. I'm right here. So now, remember, the destroyer, Nicholas, Saint Nicholas, Santa Claus, the destroyer of the congregation. What does Saint Nicholas destroy? Your family. If they can get your kids not to focus on the real reason for the season, when they get older, now Christmas becomes commercialized and they go into debt, they go into all kind of craziness to get gifts because Santa Claus got to come down the chimney, get the cookies and the milk, have his pot belly all out, eat your food up, go away. But guess what happens on December 31st? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Happy New Year, Red Doom. But Saint Nick got everybody and said, listen, charge up your credit cards, spend all your money, Red Doom. The destroyer of the congregation, the destroyer of the family, the Nicolaitan is a destroyer. And if it's in your ministry, man of God, you must recognize it and ask God to send fire to your house, that every Nicolaitan spirit burn up what burn it all up. because it's what it is. I hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, because the Lord knows these are replicas of the accuser of the brethren. And also, what does God say? He said, it's good and perfect when brethren dwell together. And the Nicolaitan spirit comes to counter that very scripture. And you can have a Nicolaitan in your house. That's why you and your husband are fighting. So you've been praying against a spirit of division, but you should be praying against the Nicolaitan spirit in your husband, who's a deacon at the church, who's a pastor at the church, who's whatever, at the elder or a member, the Nicolaitan spirit in him. Yes. There's the spirit of Nicolaitans is one who was a church prostitute, never stays in one ministry, doesn't serve, goes to find a place where they can fit in, don't submit to nobody. But then everybody's service, trying to find a way to get on staff, trying to get and mess with your daughters, your spiritual, and put them nasty paws on your spiritual daughters. Let your daughters know that Nicolai, let fire fall even this Sunday in the houses of God represented tonight to burn up. I mean, the devil, that's why I've been attacking the last 2 weeks. The devil is mad. I don't care. I don't care. Let them attack. I'll speak even more bold about it. The Nicolaitan spirit lies about their credentials. Let me sip this real quick. The Nicolaitan spirit lies about their credentials. I was a prophet at my last church, but there's no fruit following. I was an apostle at my last church, or I'm an apostle, but you have no sons, no daughters, you plant no churches, you have no power, you don't move miracles, signs, and wonders, which should follow the office of an apostle. That's part of his calling. I'm a prophet, but you don't prophesy. I'm a pastor with no church. Nobody following you, because what does pastors do? They gather. So nobody following you, sir, ma'am. You are not a pastor. You are Nicolaitan. The Nicolaitans are something. And what did Jesus say to the church? He said, you have amongst you those that call themselves an apostle. But you have found them to be liars. But there's no fruit following. It's called a Nicolaitan. You made yourself a pastor. You made yourself a prophet, and now your life is in shambles because the warfare that's attached to prophets you can't handle. The warfare attached to apostles you can't handle, but you call yourself one because you can't figure out why you feel the need to be important. It's because you are Nicolaitan, and you go and tear churches up, and you cause the people to turn against the man of God who's ordained by God. You get into the armor bearer's ear and tell them what the pastor should be doing, because you know the armor bearer talks close to the prophet. So I'm gonna tell him a few things because I know it'll get relayed. But someone who's discerning, especially in Spirit Nation, I know, get thee behind me, Satan. For yours is not the will of God. So even if it comes through somebody who's close to me by position and relationship. So now we understand, class, the deeds of the Nicolaitans is to destroy the congregation. You wonder why your church split, ma'am? You wonder why your church split, sir? It's because the Nicolaitans were in operation on you. And now their representative have a church down the street that's not growing, it's not flowing, but it took your faithful members with them. The Nicolaitan was an armor bearer who was jealous of you. Because you're the set man and he thought he could do it better than you. So he'll ruin your church, come against your church, and tear down what God was trying to build, because he's a destroyer of the congregation. Nicolaitans want power. They appear to be pure, but they want power. They're power hungry. But only God can delegate power, and only God can delegate authority. So Nicolaitans, the camera speaks truth about them. When they get on Facebook and they put these little boring posts, they have no authority and no one listens because they're Nicolaitan. They speak on church matters above their pay grade because they want to be high up there, but God has put his foot on them and now they're just laymen. Nicolaitans. They're on Facebook and you watch them preach and there's no fire, there's no nothing. They're boring, dead, and dry. And Nicolaitans on camera. They said back in 1920 I did miracles, but they forgot they were born in 1980. The Nicolaitans. You understand, class? Why God said, I hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Why? They destroy the congregation. They bring division. They always try to rebuke something or somebody, and they have no authority. I hate the deeds of them. So you got to check yourself. Am I functioning like a Nicolaitan? Or am I supporting the man of God that God has set? Shikoba. Or am I jockeying for his position that you'll never get? You have to check your own self to make sure you're not a divider of the brethren, that you're not a one tearing down churches. My God in heaven, that's class. In a nutshell, it's what the Nicolaitans are and what they do. So man of God, if you're on tonight, woman of God with your own ministries, you have to now go and engage the Nicolaitan spirit that's already in your house. And you do it by fire and by power. And God will show you which one has a Nicolaitan spirit within. Doesn't possess them, but it's within. Remember, and Judas and Nicholas. We read that verse a whole life and had no idea that the Nicolaitan was right here. He tore the church up from the inside. An infiltrator. Sobatashika. Mm-hmm. The Nicolaitans tell themselves when they make these those dumb posts on Facebook that nobody likes and nobody paying attention to. Sit down somewhere. Or they get up there and preach because they trick somebody to get a microphone and there's no fire, there's no power, there's nothing. You're seeing a Nicolaitan in action. Oh, I'm prophet such and such, but you don't prophesy. Nothing comes to pass if you do say something that you guesstimate. I see you living in the house. Well, duh. I live in the house. So do you. Get in on it. I'm done, honey. Wow. Listen, class. I'm done for the night. Amen. Wow. I'm thinking about doing a part two of the Nicolaitans. I'll think about it. Amen. Well, I'll think about it. But let's plan on going to the rapture on next Thursday, and I want you to get that message to your whole friends and families. We have been working this thing since September, and we're about to come to a close here next week or the week after, we'll see. But we're working, and we have built all this up for the rapture, the next major event to happen to the world as we know it. And I'm telling you, class, you got to get your family saved because we're racing towards the rapture. We are. May your ticket be punched. Let's get other people in line to get their reservation. Amen. Remember, the Laodicean church, recap, lukewarm will reduce you to something where you just go through the motions. You're not on fire for God like you used to. You don't burn for him like you used to. We go through the motions. We come on Sundays. We don't bring anybody. We don't invite anybody. We don't witness to anybody. And we have a dying world out there. Talk to somebody who don't look like you. Give them a card. I mean, my wife and I gave them some cards for our church. I hope you guys are passing those out. We have some more things, hopefully this week, I don't know, we can get those out. Those are witnessing tools to get people to come and see, because we actually care about people. Sobatishika. Yeah, amen, honey. Amen. The Nicolaitan spirit, amen. With Nicolaitans and Judas, Matthew chapter 10, Acts chapter 6, you go back and read on your own and see the correlation. They pick leadership. And Nicholas. Need I say more? Amen. Amen. All right, Claire, listen, we love you so dearly, so very much. Amen. We're 90 minutes into our broadcast, and we are done for tonight. We will be back. We love you all. We love you all so, 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 so much. Amen. We love you all so much. And we're praying for you. Even if you don't comment, I'll just comment and get your weekly filet mignon, ribeye, what have you. That's fine. Amen. As long as you get something to eat. Amen. I don't care where you're at and where you come from. I don't care. Amen. Because the word is the word is the word. but don't be a Nicolaitan that hops from church to church to church to church, book to book to book. Anyway, love you all so much. We're praying for you. Men, I will see you on Saturday. It's in our group, Amen. Yes. Bring the young dudes too, man. Bring the young fellas. I'm going to bring Deacon BJ with me. And he has a few words for the men of Spirit Nation. So I'm going to let him talk his own trash to you all. Amen. Yes. Thank you so much, my sister. God bless you, Nikki, and all those who are submitting some very kind words. We love you all so, so, so much. Amen. Now we understand why there are church splits. We understand now. You get fed in Spirit Nation. Amen. You get fed here. So we can understand and put up countermeasures and pray and ask God to send a fire into the church of God. So we don't have any more church hurt. People have been hurt by church because of the Nicolaitan spirit operating in people and other things too, plus demons, everything else. But the Nicolaitan spirit has taken people out of the church. And when it created their own church, how are you going to start a church out of my church? God handing on that. That's a lie. So Bishop Rockwell down the road, who was a Nicolaitan who took your members, and now he's an apostle. He called himself that. You're going to have some division in your home. So you, how it trickles down. Division started this. Division's on the head, man. It now gets into the homes. So everybody's marriage is all jacked up and family. Because the Nicolaitan spirit doesn't die, it multiplies. Put water on it. Gizmo style. Put water on it. Gremlin style. Gremlins are coming together with big pointy ears. You understand? That's why the house is all jacked up some places. Anyway, I'm done. Hey, man, listen, we love you all so much. Have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful night. And dream big. Sunday, power up Sunday. Amen. Yes. And we're going to have our healing, and we're going to have our prophecy. Every Sunday, that's what we're doing. Bring the lost. Bring the sick. Bring the downcast. Bring the Muslims. Bring them all. Bring the Hindu. All up, bring them in there. Amen. Let's get in on it. It's time to win people to Christ. Let's get in on it. Amen. Bring them. Because we're going to show them that there's only one God. Only one. And his name is Jehovah. Jireh. Shiskanu. Macadash. I can keep going. Amen. Listen, we're looking forward to you. Rafa. Yes, come and see. Amen. Come and see. Listen, we love you all. Love you, Spirit Nation team, leadership, and members. Love you, those around the world, a nation, etc. We love you all so much. Listen, we're coming to a city near you. Amen. We are. So we're going to work that out. We're going to work that out. Amen. Amen. All right, class, I'm done. I could be here all night, and I'm not going to. Yes, power up Sunday. Amen. So you should come get in on it. All right, I'm done. Listen, if you feel so compelled to get in on the giving information, let me put it up for you, is on the screen in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Amen. And you feel this message will bless your life in any way, form, fashion, and you want to give something, listen, from 1 cent to $1 million, we'll take it. Amen. But let it come from your heart. That's all I ask for. And what God asks for, let it come from a place that you're not scared, that God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. Amen. Those who sow bountifully. It's okay. It's okay, baby. Oh, see if y'all, what y'all see in my house? Those who sow sparingly shall reap sparingly, and those who sow bountifully shall sow bountifully. Amen. Amen. Look, that's my backyard. You can see it back there. All there, but I don't care. My wife do. Let me get off here because she's trying to get the TV. Oh, man. It's okay, honey.
Love you all so much. See you Sunday. God, I thank you for the people tonight that chimed in. I thank you that you bless them, God. Even as we conclude next week, three blessings be upon their life for what they have stuck through these last few months as we have worked your revelation as you commanded me to do. And even tonight, God, and as they go forth and learn and teach with other people, they will understand. Understand what you are teaching, what you're saying to the church in this hour. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. I'm sorry, I just had a vision real quick, and we'll tell that Sunday. Amen. Love you all so much. We're praying for you. God bless you. We'll see you Sunday. Take care.